Good morning and welcome to Christ Baptist Church in Burlington, New Jersey. There is something about church when the called out ones of God gather to share His victories in their lives. In this season, we boldly acknowledge that the building is not the church. You and I, we're the church, and today and every day, the church is open. Today, we meet through electronic media to defy the prince of the power of the air with the authority of the King of the air and everything, Jesus the Christ. Certainly we miss the smiles, handshakes, and hugs of all our brothers and sisters, but we will not be hindered in meeting and gathering together to worship. Please get your Bibles along with your family and neighbors to join you in a Holy Ghost worship experience.
Good morning to the Kingdom of Christ. Thanking God for another day. We ought to give God praise when we get up this morning. So glad we have another chance to come and worship God and to give glory to His name. And sometimes we get up in the morning and we're just so glad to put our feet on the floor. But isn't it good when we can move around and have our being? God has made it possible for us to come today to worship Him, to adore Him, and to praise Him. Let us pray. God, we thank You for another day. We thank You for our sleep last night. We thank You for rising this morning. We thank You, Father God, that we woke up this morning clothed in our right minds. We thank You, Lord, we have a reasonable portion of health and strength, activity of our limbs, articulation of speech. And by that, God, we're able to give You praise. We come to praise You with our singing. We come to praise You with our reading. Come to praise You in prayer. Come to praise You, God, with the word. And we pray, oh Lord God, that You would be glorified in all that shall be done today. We're praying that somebody may need to find You. Someone may need to have a relationship with You. And today, God, You're going to reach where they are. Thank You for this medium of the internet, this medium of the airwaves, whereby we're able to get this message through and touch the hearts of people. And we're asking You, Father God, to touch each one of our bodies, all that are involved in this worship today. Strengthen us right now in the name of Your Son, Jesus, that, Lord, You can get the powerful glory out of our message and work for You. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Our morning scripture reading is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians, the fourth chapter. And we're going to read verses 8 through 18 together. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Praising God for His word. Amen. His word is so true. His word is so relevant for our lives, and we are so thankful. As you're getting your Bibles or turning on your tablets, turning on your iPads, we're praising God for you. 2 Corinthians, the fourth chapter, and we're going to start reading at verse number 8. Let us read. We are hard-pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. For we who live are always delivered to death for Jesus' sake, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So then, death is working in us, but life in you. And since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, I believed and therefore I spoke. We also believe and therefore speak, knowing that He who raised up the Lord Jesus will also raise us up with Jesus and will present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that grace, having spread through the many, may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God. Amen. May God add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of His word. Our morning hymn is a hymn that is very familiar to us. I need you. I need you every hour. I need you. The words that come up on the screen, prepare our hearts and minds as we go before God and ask Him to come into our lives. Amen. Where else there to go? When you need help, when you need supply, when you need sufficiency, except go to the Lord. Praise God. Amen. We'd like to take this opportunity to welcome those who are visiting with us today at Christ Baptist Church. We praise God for your taking time out of your schedule to stop in. And a number of people I know, they visit with this being at home, not having to drive. We can go to two, three sites on a Sunday. And we thank you that you've chosen Christ Baptist as one of the places you stopped by. I ask you to keep us in your prayers. A lot going on in the kingdom as well as here at Christ Baptist. And so we look forward to seeing you when this COVID pandemic is over. You can come in and worship with us. Amen. At this time, we're going to have a couple of announcements. We ask you, please give heed to these announcements. We'll be right back with you.
Give Plus. Electronic giving is fast, easy, and convenient. There are three ways you can give electronically: online, mobile app, or text. Online giving. Go to our website and click the Give tab. Give a single gift or schedule ongoing donations using your checking account, debit, or credit card. Mobile app. Download the mobile app Give Plus on your smartphone or tablet from your app store. Second, find Christ Baptist Church. Third, then give. Text. Just text the amount you wish to give to the following number, 609-676-2039. Tithes and donations can also be mailed to Christ Baptist Church, P.O. Box 10, Burlington, New Jersey, 08016. God's Word says, "Let each man do according as he hath purposed in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver."
Good morning, Christ Baptist Church. Here are your announcements for today.
This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. As we continue to be compliant with the New Jersey State parameters for social distancing and worship, know that our Lord God is ever so near to us.
Birthday blessings and anniversary blessings to all who celebrated in June and July, and if you are celebrating a birthday or anniversary in August, view our list on our Christ Baptist Church website. Again, happy birthday or happy anniversary.
To our Christ Baptist Church members, online viewers, family, and friends, we have received so many wonderful cards, emails, texts, letters, and posts showing appreciation for our various outreaches that have ministered to you in a special way during this time. Please keep letting us know how God is using this ministry to touch lives. We count it a blessing, and we look forward to continuing to share the love of Jesus in the power of the Holy Spirit as God leads. Thanks again for reaching out to us in such thoughtful and encouraging ways.
Have a wonderful day, and may the Lord continue to richly bless you.
Amen. Amen. Thanking you for giving heed to those announcements. We also want to announce to you, please join us on our Tuesday night Bible study. We just started a new series last Tuesday called I Am a Church Member, a book by Tom S. Rainer. We're very excited over our young adults who were with us in our lesson class, and we were able to have some dialogue, and we're going to do that. That'll happen over the course of this study as we're looking for different perspectives than us OG people. Amen. We thank God for their input and for their caring about their church and the kingdom of Christ. Amen. We also want to remind you about our Sunday night Bible study. It's Sunday evening at 7 p.m. It's called Bible Essentials, and we do encourage you to come and study with us. It's a half hour. And in that half hour, we're discussing things even that are going on right now, things that are current in our society. We will be moving further into the book of Revelations in that tribulation period, and looking at some of the things happening there as we head toward looking at the fifth horseman. We saw the four horsemen in Revelation 6. We're going to be moving forward. So remember, Bible study on Tuesday night at 7 p.m., Sunday night at 7 p.m. Let us pray. Eternal God, we do thank you, Lord, for this time that your people have given. They gave, dear God, because you told us in your word that when we bring the tithes to the storehouse, you would open the windows of heaven and pour us out a blessing we would not have room enough to receive. You told us in your word, God, in Proverbs 3, that when we bring you the first fruit, that you would increase the fruit in our vine and you would help us keep what we already possess in our barns. Thank you, God, for your faithfulness. Thank you for the dedication and faithfulness of your people. Thank you for those, God, who are not even a member of this fellowship, but desire to send in a donation to help us in the work of ministry. Thank you, God, as we're still doing ministry work through the giving of your people in India and in the Bahamas and in Haiti and in all over this country. And right here in Burlington, God, through the dedication of your people, we're able to do the work of ministry. Thank you, Lord. Bless it now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. As we prepare ourselves for prayer, I want to ask you, please remember in your time of prayer, those persons who over the course of this pandemic have lost loved ones, the names will come back to you. If they're coming back, you may be walking around the house. Please lift those names up in prayer. Those who maybe have lost somebody from a year ago or 2 years ago, please continue to pray for them, that God would strengthen them. Please remember our sister Donna Brewington in your time of prayer. She lost a cousin. Lift that up before the Lord. Please remember Sister Sharon Fitzgerald also lost a cousin, and lift that before God, that God would strengthen their families in a time of loss. Please remember Sister Edwina Williams in your prayers. God is still a miracle-working God, and there are things that we don't comprehend, don't understand, but God is able to bring them through. Sister Edwina Williams, please remember Sister Evelyn Williams in your prayers. Continue to pray for her, that God would strengthen her body. We ask you to lift the name Lorraine up before the Lord. Former co-worker of mine from years ago when I worked back in the 80s, and her cancer came back. Let's believe God that God is going to move that cancer out of her life. Please remember Sister Evangeline Watson in your prayers, dear sister of Christ Baptist, and remember that God would continue to move in areas that she has need in her life. This song will take us to our time of prayer.
Sometimes I feel like giving up. It seems like my best just ain't good enough. Lord, if you hear me, I'm calling you. Do you see, do you care all about what I'm going through? And then he said, one more day, one more step. See, I'm preparing you for myself. And when you can't hear my voice, please trust my plan. I'm the Lord, I see, and yes, I understand. Sometimes I feel like I'm all alone. I'm just like a stranger so far from home. I feel like I've done all that I can do. Please, Lord, give me strength. I'm just trying to make it through. That's when he told me.
Gracious God, we thank you, Lord, that being honest with ourselves and with you, Lord, there are sometimes, God, we just don't understand. We just don't understand, God, that after purposing in our hearts to serve you, why there's still hatred in our land. Purposing in our hearts, God, that we can say we're serving the same God, but those that you love, we don't treat the same. I pray right now, God, that all of this prejudice and bigotry and racism that's pervading our nation, I'm praying, God, that you would do something about it right now in the name of Jesus. In this time of reflection, God, I pray that men would see what you say in your word, that you are not a respecter of persons. I'm asking you to remember those names that were called out today, God. Remember those that are sick in their body, those who have diseases that have invaded their lives, and yet, God, you're still able to do exceeding and abundantly above everything that we ask or think. We're asking you, oh Father God, to please remember those who are in nursing homes. Thank you for those nursing homes that visit with us on Sunday, Lord. We're asking, oh God, for you to please remember those who had death in their family And we can't even celebrate the life of that person the way we used to. But God, we ask you right now, in the name of Jesus, would you help us understand, comfort us, God, with the comfort that we're going to need in this hour. God, you give us another day. You give us another time. I'm praying, God, that we use that time for the benefit of growing your kingdom. I'm praying that selfishness and envy and jealousy move aside, God, as we purpose our minds to serve you in spirit and in truth. I'm praying for Christ Baptist Church, God. You know what we're going through. So, Lord, guide those who are giving leadership. Guide those who are part of the pulpit search committee. Guide those, oh God, who have to, as we come into work each day, to do your work for your kingdom building. We ask you to bless churches, God, all over this land and country that have purpose to walk with you. Another day, God, you've given us. We pray we're beneficial and we edify your body in it. We ask these things in the matchless, the mighty and the marvelous name of your son, Jesus. We thank you, God. Thank you, God, for who you are. Amen, amen, amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Praise God. Let's prepare ourselves for the preached word. This next song will lead us into that. We pray as we get our hearts ready. Let's hear what God has to say to us.
People are dying, and people are crying for a savior to come and save us from this world. Now, God, I'm calling your name, 'cause my world does need change. In Jesus' name. So, oh God, we need you to pull us through. People are hurting.
God, we need you to pull us through. We need you, God, to bring us out. We need you, God, to walk with us and to talk with us, and we need you to bring us in. We praise you, oh Father God, for your being with us throughout this journey, leading us, guiding us, directing us. And we pray right now, God, in the name of your Son, Jesus, that as we stand to proclaim your word, we're praying, oh Father God, for a fresh anointing of your Holy Spirit, that we may speak your word with clarity and with power. Speak to us and speak through us. Spirit of the living God, fall new and fall fresh. And we ask this in the matchless, mighty, and marvelous name of Jesus. Thank you, God. Amen. 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 Come on, if you've ever been pulled through by God, you ought to give the Lord praise. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Amen. We invite you to turn with us this morning to the book of Acts, Acts chapter 14. Acts chapter 14, and we will be starting at verse number 1. Acts chapter 14, and we will be directing our attention to the first verse. Amen. We're praising God. One of the things that I have a fondness for is exegetical narrative expository preaching. And I like it because you get to see the whole story. You don't get pieces of it as we do many times in thematic preaching. Exegetical narrative expository, you get to see the whole thing unfold. Amen. Acts chapter 14. As you're looking there, there's a jumping off spot. In the second epilogue of War and Peace, Leo Tolstoy argues the opposition between what he calls the law of relativity in history and the consciousness of free will. Tolstoy raises this idea that this opposition resides in people trying to figure out or trying to harmonize divine election and human volition. What Tolstoy says in the writing is that when we start to see that God has already laid out some things, and even though we do things, we never frustrate the purpose of God, but you can't harmonize them, but they do coexist in order that life, as life is flowing through, these things are happening. Now, I want you to understand something. This makes it very difficult for a history writer, as the writer in Acts is showing us. It makes it difficult to try and show what is going on in a particular text, especially as we see things happening and wondering, why don't they know that God is going to intervene? For we learn in Acts chapter 15, verse 18, that known unto God are his works from the beginning of the world. God has known all along what you and I were going to do, and he still has a plan that will bring us through that. Acts chapter 14, verse number 1. Now it happened in Iconium that they went together to the synagogue of the Jews, and so spoke that a great multitude, both of the Jews and of the Greeks, believed. But the unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and poisoned their minds against the brethren. Therefore, they stayed there a long time, speaking boldly in the Lord, who was bearing witness to the word of his grace, granting signs and wonders to be done by their hands. But the multitude of the city was divided. Part sided with the Jews, part with the apostles. And when a violent attempt was made, both the Gentiles and the Jews with their rulers, to abuse and stone them, they became aware of it and fled to Lystra and Derbe and cities of Lycaonia and to the surrounding region, and they were preaching the gospel there. I'll talk this morning from the subject, episodic encore. Episodic encore. What happens when divine purpose becomes a nevertheless inflection? What happens when God's purpose, as he's trying to move, as he's moving things through life for people, becomes a nevertheless inflection? And we're using the word inflection as a term, as a word form that changes in order to bring forth meaning. As we look at the Bible, what we notice is that there are some times, there are some nevertheless moments, there are some in spite of moments, there are some notwithstanding moments, there are some at the same time moments that go on in Scripture that if we go quickly, we'll miss it. We were looking the other week at between now and then, and we told you that in chapter 13, verse number 13, now was the word deh, D-E-H, in the Greek. And in verse 14, but was deh. And in verse 15, and was deh. And in verse 16, then was deh. So what gives us the idea of which English word that the translators was going to use had to do with the setting. Here we are in Acts chapter 14. And Acts chapter 14, verse number 1 says, now it happened. And here, a good translation of the word is not just now, but nevertheless. And the reason why nevertheless is a great term for this, because nevertheless here helps you as a listener and me as a reader, it helps us to understand that something is happening, and while it is happening, even though it's there, there's something else that could have stopped it but didn't, because we see it right here in our text. Now, let's just go back in our remembrance. Acts chapter 13 ends, verse 51, with Paul and Barnabas shaking the dust off their feet, leaving out of Antioch and Pisidia, and they were headed for Iconium. Acts chapter 13, verse 52 says, and they were filled with joy and the Holy Spirit. The disciples were filled with joy. That's what I'm talking about, the exegetical narrative. If I would have just separated chapter 13 all by itself, it hooks right in here. The text lets us know that they left chapter 13, 52. They left out of Antioch and Pisidia, filled with the Holy Spirit, and filled with joy. You know what that's like. Leaving church on Sunday, leaving church from Bible study, leaving church from prayer service, and the Spirit of God is welling in you. And as the Spirit of God is welling in you, there comes a nevertheless inflection. Something happens, something occurs that attempts to mess with the purpose of God and your joy, in your happiness, in your moving forward. Now watch this, because it happens right here in our text. In our text, it almost, this nevertheless, becomes a, oh, not again. Yeah, we had in chapter 13, at the latter part of the chapter, after they preached powerfully, if you remember, people started to believe in God. Great things was going on in Antioch and Pisidia, but everybody was not happy over the great things that were going on. There were some Jewish leaders who had a problem with all of the glory that was going to Paul and Barnabas. And so what they did was they stirred up a problem over there. They left out, shook the dust off their feet. They come over to Iconium and not again. Here we go again. Same problem. It suggests to me that there's something that is going on that is attempting to distract people from coming to a knowledge of who God is. And sometimes the distraction is not on the outside. Sometimes the distraction is right here in the church. In our text, when you see these not again moments, sometimes it creates frustration. Sometimes it creates anger. Sometimes it raises up inside of us exasperation that just when we think we're making progress, not again, here we go. By the way, the not again the tenor of Scripture we find in Galatians chapter 5. Paul writes to those in Galatians chapter 5, verse number 1, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. You were in bondage. Don't get caught up in bondage again. Now, the word that is used there, the word that is entangled, eneko, is a word that means to hold in or to ensnare. It's a word that carries with it the idea is to hold a grudge. Don't let a grudge that you have against somebody mess with your progress with God and somebody else's progress. Don't let this thing, don't put yourself in a position that you're unable to free yourselves, he says, because you've become entangled again with the same bondage. Let me give you another use of it. 2 Peter chapter 2. Peter writes, those who escape the corrupting forces of the world through the experience of knowing who Jesus is. Peter says, then to go back into entanglement, same word, you will find yourself being defeated by the very thing that you're going back and being entangled by. Peter says to them, he says, verse 21, he says, it's better off for you never to have known the way of righteousness than to fall back into the same entanglements that you were in before. Beloved, when God has brought you out of something, why would you allow yourself to get caught up and entangled in that same thing again? And here's what we understand as we're looking at our text, because even we see that there's the atrocities that are going on as we're applying this text, as the atrocities that are going on in our world today, the racial hatred that's going on, perhaps it is not a still again. Perhaps this hatred that is going on is something that's been covered up. And I declare to you, all of it wasn't covered up with sheets. Some of it was covered up in other ways. But beloved, it's deep and it's there. And unless God moves in and moves that bitterness and that hatred out, America still will be a divided nation. One nation under God, indivisible. We're not under God. God is not divided. How can a nation be divided as America is today? In our text, they had a great time in Pisidia, but things broke out. There's a dual implication in Acts 13, 52, by the way. The implication is the people who heard the gospel were full of joy and the Holy Spirit. But it also has the implication of Paul and Barnabas being full of joy and the Holy Spirit. Can I suggest something to you this morning? That whenever God is doing a great work in the midst of his people, no matter what kind of hell is breaking out around us, we are joyful to know that God's purpose is going to take place. Lives are being changed. People are doing better. Folks are maturing and growing up in God. And so the text changes. Now, no doubt, it is disappointing when you're doing the best that you can and opposition come against you. In fact, sometimes we don't even know the opposition is there. We don't see it because some people, they do stuff clandestine. They do it sneakily. They don't come right out. But the text lets us know that these were bold people. This text in Iconion is a mirror image of what happened in Pisidia. And when we start to see it, the text lets us know that there's a certain restiveness on the part of the Jews, both in Antioch and in Iconion. There's a restiveness. Now, let me just talk. I mentioned restiveness, I think, before, but let me just get a little further. Restiveness really means to be impatient of control. Restiveness is a lack of restraint. It is usually caused by delay. When things don't go the way we want. Second definition of restiveness is to be stubborn and refractory. Refractory means hard or impossible to manage. Third definition of restiveness is refusing to go forward. Let me see if I can give you an example of restiveness. Restiveness is getting on your plane to take your flight. The plane pulls out from the gate, gets out on the runway, and you got to sit out there for over an hour before it takes off. And you get restive. You want to know, when is this thing taking off? Because at least I should be in the air. What we don't realize sometimes, beloved, is that God held that plane on the ground to prevent us from something that was ahead of us. We ought to be thanking God. God, I thank you that you held me up. It's like those days you're ready to leave the house and you just cannot find your car keys. You look everywhere you can. And they're not there. I want to help you this morning. Do you notice that when you lose your keys, when you find them, they're always in the last place you look? Just think about it just for a minute. Because if they were in the first place, you wouldn't have kept looking. God gives us the opportunity to hold back, to stand back, and hold out from some things that we don't even notice down the road from us. They're suffering from restiveness. And the only cure for restiveness we find in Philippians chapter 4. The only remedy is godly peace and a guarded heart. For those who are rested, for things not happening fast like you wanted to, guarded peace and a guarded heart and a heart that where the peace of God can pervade and take control. And so we start to read Philippians 4:7. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your petitions be made known unto God, and the peace of God that passeth all understanding, listen, will keep your heart and your mind through Christ Jesus. It is by God giving us his peace and by us guarding our hearts. In our text, now at Iconion, New King James, now it happened in Iconion. Amplified says, now at Iconion. The Passion Translation says, Paul and Barnabas arrived in Iconion and the same thing happened there. What same thing? The same thing that happened back in Antioch and Pisidia. The same thing happens in Iconion that happened in Pisidia. And when you understand, what caused it? Well, it was very simple. In Antioch as well as in Iconion. The text tells us that they went to the synagogue. And when they went to the synagogue, they preached with power. And as they were preaching with power, a great number of Jews and Gentiles believed on Jesus. And as they believed, opposition arose. Why would people be upset over somebody getting saved? Why would people let that mess with them that God is using somebody else? Well, there's four things I want to raise, and we're going to be done today. The first thing is I look at this text. There's noteworthy in the text. Chapter 14, verse number 1. There is an extensive conversion. Look at the text. A great multitude of Jews and Greeks believed. I believe that the gospel ought to be presented in such a fashion that it has a cordial invite to people coming in from a mean world. And they should see the cordial nature of the gospel, that they can come to repentance because the gospel is fresh and it's warm and it's inviting. The gospel should not be that which drives people away. That's why the Holy Spirit uses the gospel to bring people to a saving knowledge of who Christ is. Preaching ought to be that which enlightens the mind, excites the heart to turn from whatever things are going on in life and turn to God. There is a preaching that produces a God-desired result. And that's what we should be giving. And that's what Paul and Barnabas was giving. We ought to preach with a design that people can secure faith. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We ought to preach so that people can see that if I have faith in God, life can be different. Cicero remarked that if the feelings with which you represent truth and truth itself do not accord, you've misrepresented the truth. If I preach with a feeling of a desire for my brothers and sisters to come to Christ, then that desire ought to be united with a truth that draws them in. It should not be something that pushes them out. We ought to preach with consistent truth. You shouldn't get confused over here and something different over here. That's why it's important as a pastor, as a leader in the church, if somebody's going to preach something different than what I'm preaching as pastor, then that person can't preach. We can't allow that because it creates a confusion in the body of Christ. Or somebody, well, let the Holy Spirit solve it. The Holy Spirit has solved it. Holy Spirit says, you are the one who is responsible for the souls of these people. So we ought to preach a truth that is consistent with a singular harmonious design that men can come to a saving knowledge of the Christ. Finally, we ought to preach where there can be a way of application to the hearers. Sermons are not meant, messages are not meant for us to say how much we enjoyed them. Messages are meant to change our lives and turn them toward God. There's an extensive conversion in verse number 1 as Paul and Barnabas is presenting truth. But then notice, verse 2, there's an enraged contention. There's an enraged contention. Look, verse, unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and poisoned their minds. The word poison, kakul, is a word that means to vex, to harm, or to injure. They didn't just mess with the Paul and Barnabas, the preachers that were preaching, it injured the ones that they were trying to, that it poisoned their minds. And the text says, as they poisoned their minds, it poisoned them against the brethren. Listen, as this contention is going on, those who reject the truth of the word of God have no problem seeking to deter others from receiving that truth for them to be changed. They poison their minds. Now, we're not told exactly what they said, but what we understand is it's easy to pervert somebody's mind about the preacher, about the pastor, about who's presenting the word. It's easy to say things that would cause people to say, I don't want to hear from them. And many times we say it ways that are clever, but they're not clever at all. There was an enraged contention because Paul and Barnabas was preaching truth. There's not only an extensive conversion and enraged contention. Thirdly, there was an exalted confirmation. Look at verse number 3. Unlike what happened at Pisidia, where the Holy Spirit gave them license, shake the dust off your feet and leave. The text says in verse number 3, Paul and Barnabas stayed there. In spite of the contention, in spite of the stuff that's going on, they stayed there. And they spoke boldly, watch this, in the Lord. I don't have time to deal with the crazy Paul was saying, Barnabas was saying. I'm going to keep on doing what God told us to do. They spoke boldly in the Lord, bearing witness, look at the text, to the word of his grace. And what did God do? God granted signs and wonders. When you stay faithful to God, God does his miracle working power in the midst of his people. God showed us signs and wonders. And neither it didn't lessen their display of divine power, because even in their message, in their subject, it is the word of his grace. How can you be mad about the word of his grace? In the spirit, speaking boldly, they showed how heroic it is. I don't have to cower. I don't have to punk down. I can stand firm and say, my God has my back. He's in front of me. He's the sword in my hand. Paul and Barnabas kept preaching the word, and God declared an amen to the word by giving them signs and wonders. There's one more thing, and I'm going to be done. There's an evidenced contrariety in the text, an evidence contrariety. Verse number 4, it created social separation. I told you they poisoned the minds of the people. And verse number 4 says, but the multitude of the city was divided. It created a schizo, divide, schizo. It's where we get our word schism from. It created a divide. Some of the people were on the side of the Jews, and some of them was on the side of Paul and Barnabas. And when that divide is created, when we can't operate as a unified body carrying out the purposes of God, we become weakened. We become, Jesus said, a house divided against itself, it can't stand. It created a divide there. The enemy of God loves to divide the people of God. We go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. I'm of Paul. I'm of Apollos. I'm of Peter. I'm of Christ. Paul says, is Christ divided? God is not divided, beloved. They created a divide in the church, and the contrariety that it made, that the appeal of the gospel becomes difficult when there's a division going on inside of a body. And the searching ministry of the Holy Spirit, what happens is when God's ministry of the gospel goes forth, here's what people don't like. It makes bare, it undresses, it uncovers, it makes naked the truth of who they really are. We don't have to do it. The gospel of Jesus Christ does it. Whenever, as we look in this text, we see this division, this schizo happening. Now watch God, because God is never confounded when this happens. What God does in this text is, when this storm starts to rise, whenever storms rise, they're under the direction of God. When this storm starts to rise up, God calls a divine breeze to take the seed of what they were preaching and blow it over into another area, into Lystra, into Derbe, into Laconia. God says, if you won't receive it here, let me blow the seed over here. And the Bible says that the apostles, ultimately, they fled. Now, they stayed there a long time, but ultimately, they fled to Lystra and to Derbe. Let me share this and I'm done. As we're doing ministry, as we are carrying out our assignments that God has given us, you can rest assured we're going to have trials and tribulations. Anybody who gets in ministry, who gets involved with ministry, they ought to know early on, you're going to have problems. Because the enemy, and he really does not care who he uses, will always try to come against what God is doing in order that his motivation, his purpose. We go back to the story of Lucifer, where he raised up an insurrection in heaven and took a third of the angels with him. This idea is that troubles and trials are going to come. And the enemy, as he's planting seeds of quit in the hearts of some people, we got to realize, don't let those seeds take root. When things come and try and discourage you and make you quit, you got to say, I'm going to go on with the Lord. I'm staying with God. I'm going on with what the Lord is doing, and I'm not going to take back. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, he says, we are troubled on every side. Verse number 8. We're troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We're perplexed, yet not in despair. Persecuted, yet not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. verse number 10, he says, we are continually sharing in the death of Jesus so that the resurrection of Christ will raise us up. So that the very things that look like it's going to take us down really is giving us life. Merrill Tenney, 20th century theologian, teacher, pastor. Merrill Tenney, in an essay entitled Exploring the Conceptual Compatibility, Exploring the Conceptual Compatibility of the Transforming Learning Theory. It was an essay that he wrote. And he took this text of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, and Tenney says it this way. Tenney says, we are squeezed, but we're not squashed. You ever been in a car with a whole bunch of kids when you were small? And you may have been squeezed in. You were squeezed in, but you wasn't squashed. Tenney says, we may be bewildered, but we're not befuddled. I mean, even though things have me a little confused right now, God is going to bring clarity to it. Tenney says that we may be pursued, but we're not abandoned. And I love the last one. He says, I may be knocked down, but I'm not knocked out. Because as long as I can get up for another count, I'm getting up. I'm not staying down there. I stay down there and rest of the count to nine. I'm getting back up again. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus Christ. Always remembering that the life that is in Christ is in me. It's a resurrected power life that raises me up. It's been said of Napoleon that he had an unquestioned magic for victory. And the reason why is because he had no technique for defeat. He said, I don't even know what defeat looked like. All I know is how to win. And so if it looked like you thought he lost, it wasn't. It was just on his way onto another win. We've got to get the same mindset that when the enemy is coming against us, we got to say, I am not going to quit. I'm not going to stop. I'm not going to stop pursuing the purpose that God has in my life. Even when these fragile vessels, these earthen vessels, become compressed and pressured by outside forces, we have the power of God on the inside pushing back on the pressure. We cannot be broken. We cannot be destroyed. Because there is, when episodic encores happen in life, when things happen that happened before, beloved, we don't have to go through life talking about, oh, here we go again. No, not to the believer in Christ. It's not here we go again. It's here comes God again. Because as much as you come against me, God's going to come in and help. And so episodic encores is not a frightening thing to a believer. Because we know that our Savior, by his death and his resurrection, puts power inside of us that we have life that will keep on living in spite of what comes against us. So we need some hard believing believers today to say, you know what? Even when problems arise, even when troubles come up, I think I'm going forward. I think I'm going on. Even though I'm tired, even though I'm a little disappointed, exasperated, I think I'm going on. Even though it looked like that you had me blocked, I think I'm going on. Because when I make up my mind to go forward rather than keep looking backwards, I see the victory of God in his work and everything that I'm doing in the name of the sake of the kingdom. Does anybody out there today that is not saved, not born again, not in the family of God? There's a truth that you have to come to understand. And that truth is that unless you make up your mind, you're going to keep on walking with God. Unless you make up your mind that nothing is going to turn you back. In case you make up your mind that God is the one that's going to give you the power to keep going forward, you'll turn back. Jesus, though he said, Father, forgive them, though Jesus said, Father, take this cup from me, he still went to the cross. He still died for you and I. He still shed his blood in order that we can be brought back into a relationship with God. Because when we trust God and what he's doing, what he's purposing through us, it gives us a determination to say, I'm going to keep moving. I'm going to keep moving. There's an old song says, I feel like going on now. I feel like going on. Though trials come on every hand, I feel like going on. If you know it, sing it at home with us. I feel like going on. I feel like going on. Though storms may rage, though the stars may seem far, I feel like going on. There's one person out there who's not saved, not born again, not in the family of God. God wants you to come into his army. He wants you to have a determination that he's going to bring victory in, with, and through you. And you got to make up your mind that troubles and trials and problems will come. But you got to make up your mind, I'm going on. Listen, if you're not saved, if you're not born again, all you have to do is say, Lord, I admit that I am a sinner. Lord, I admit that there's some things that I've heard from the preacher, or I heard from my mama, but I heard from my grandmama. I admit that there's some things, God, that are troubling to you. And now, Lord, I want to turn my life around. I want to yield myself to you. I believe what the preacher said, that your son Jesus died for my sins, and his resurrected life can live inside of me. And I confess my sins to you. And by that confession, God, I pray right now that you would hear me and receive me into your family. The Bible says that when we confess with our mouth and believe in our heart the Lord Jesus, that God have raised him from the dead, we shall be saved. There's one person out there today. If you just admitted, believed, and confessed it right where you are already saved. And now what must happen is you must unite yourself with a Bible-teaching, Bible-believing church. The number will be given at the end of this broadcast, Christ Baptist Church, and the phone number's there. We're really not trying to get you to join Christ Baptist. We're trying to get you into the kingdom. And wherever you're living, wherever you desire, if it's a Bible-believing, Bible-teaching church there, we want to direct you there that God can nurture you and you can grow up in a fear, reverence, and admonition of Christ. I feel like going on. Trials come, but I'm not going to stop. Gracious God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, that when these episodic encores come into our lives, they don't discourage us, because you already told us that in this life we'd have trials and tribulations. We go on, Lord, knowing that you have us and you're guiding us. We're asking your blessings upon everyone that heard this word today. And those, God, that are sharing with us in worship, we pray that they would come tonight in our Bible study at 7 o'clock, God, and that we continue to learn and grow in the knowledge of your Son. Thank you for this day of worship. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Though trials come on every hand, I feel like going on. Though trials come on every hand, I feel like going on.
Thank you for joining Christ Baptist in Worship Fellowship. Remember, our Sunday night and Tuesday night Bible studies can be seen at 7 p.m. respectively. Meet us at www.cbcburlingtonnj.org or on YouTube at CBC Burlington NJ Live. Christ Baptist members, don't forget, giving is an integral part of our worship. Simply go to the Give tab at the top of our webpage and follow the prompts. Or you can mail your tithes and offerings to Christ Baptist Church, P.O. Box 10, Burlington, New Jersey, 08016. We indeed look forward to when all God's children can get together in fellowship one more time. Until then, be blessed, be prayerful, keep trusting God.